Good evening and a warm welcome to everybody who made it here on this very grim November day, and also welcome to everyone online for the book launch of Music in Exile from 1933 to the present day. My name is Stephanie Rauch. I'm head of collections here at the Wiener Holocaust Library. Tonight's event has been organized in association with the Research Center for German and Austrian Exile Studies. Music in Exile was published as part of the Yearbook of the Research Center for German and Austrian Exile Studies and was edited by Marco Miller and Jutta Raab Hansen. Leading you through the evening tonight will be Malcolm, honorary associate and associate lecturer of music at the Open University, and who has published widely on Beethoven, Wagner, and contemporary music. But just before I hand over to Malcolm, please allow me to just share a few bits of housekeeping. For those here in person, toilets are in the basement, which you can access by using the lift at the back of the building. If you hear the fire alarm going off, please take the main exit outside and follow a member of staff in a high-vis jacket across the zebra crossing to the entrance of the park for the gathering point. If you are in the toilet area, don't take the lift upstairs, but just follow the emergency lighting and the signposting to the fire exit in the basement. Also for those here in person, we do have an induction loop for those using hearing aids. You have to set your device to channel T for tango. We'll be taking questions from the audience and online. If you have any questions, please put them in the chat, and my colleague Martina, who is on the tech tonight, will be asking those questions later. And finally, if anyone in the online audience has any problems with the sound, please send a message to Martina. She will do her best to sort it out. And now over to you, Malcolm.
Thank you very much. And thank you, Stephanie, very much for your kind words of introduction. I'd also like to offer my thanks to the Wiener Library and to particularly to Toby Simpson and Barbara Warnock, who've been very helpful in arranging this event, and also to the entire team here. There's a thriving cooperation going on to get a wonderful program of events. We're very proud to be here. My name is Malcolm Miller, and together with, as you've heard, Jutta Raab Hansen, my colleague, we've co-edited the volume Music in Exile, and I'd like to welcome everybody here and online to this event to mark the publication of this yearbook number 22 of the Research Center for German and Austrian Exile Studies. And before I talk about the book, I just want to give you an idea of what we're going to do. So firstly, I'll say a few words about the book, and then I'm going to invite my co-editor Jutta to say a few words about the content of her particular specialism, her chapter in the book, followed by my esteemed colleague Norbert Meyn, who's a professor at the Royal College of Music, who will talk about his chapter, followed by a very short introduction to my chapter, so to get that into order. And then we're very, very privileged to have with us two children of the composers about whom we're going to be talking, and we're going to invite them to the front and have a discussion based around their own experiences and thoughts, and then we're going to follow that with an open discussion for everybody, with everybody who's been speaking. So I hope you'll think of some questions during the course of the evening and be able to join in. So firstly, to say that this volume has been dedicated officially to the memory of Professor Richard Dove, who is a distinguished historian and was very active with the field of exile studies, and in fact was a co-founder of this research center, and contributed many essays to many of the volumes that up to before number 22. In addition, while we're talking about the research center, I'd like to offer thanks to the chairman of the center, Tony Grenville, and to all the members, including Charmian Brinson, who one of also co-founder, who were very instrumental in thinking and supporting the idea of and suggesting the topic of music, because music is actually it's the first volume dedicated only to the topic of music in exile. Although in previous volumes of the yearbook, there have been individual essays that have touched on the subject. So the combination of 14 different and individual essays on music and exile in this volume add up to what I think and I hope will be a significant contribution to the growing literature within an ever-increasingly fruitful field. And in that way, I also leads me to say thank you to all the contributors, some of whom I think may be online at different parts of the world, stemming as they do from not only the UK, but also Germany, Austria, and America. And addressing you, I would like to say some of you have been inspiring role models in the study of exile music, which you have worked, many of you, for several decades, producing books, articles, exhibitions, and performance events, as I will talk about in a minute. And other of our contributors are younger scholars who've come into the field and have benefited from the wealth of materials that we've already have been developed in the past. I've got to say just very briefly that the field of exile music, which is it is allied in a way to the field of music and the Holocaust, is a field which in academic musicology really only took off in the late 1970s or late 1980s in different ways. And in so doing, it has managed to carve out a canon of works and a growing repertory from what was originally a sort of marginalized, even exotic curiosity to something which is now more mainstream and performed by main leading ensembles and orchestras. And that is quite a remarkable process. In some ways, it follows, just to give it a sort of parallel, the field of studies of women in music, which about 30 years ago, there was a dictionary of women in music with about a very few number of names. And the latest sort of similar reference work would have several thousand names. And it's something which has grown, and works have been introduced to audiences, not only recently, but from the history of music. And so in this way, the contribution, in a way, of the study of music in exile is far beyond academia, and it's really spreading to in the wider society. Let me just talk about the book. There are three main sections we have, focusing on different aspects of this topic. Firstly, we have three essays on cultural identities and geographical regions, I've called it. Next, we move on to individual organizations or infrastructures of society and how they impact on the life of exile musicians. And finally, we have the study of individual composers and individual works, sort of home in more detail. So with the first essay we've got here is by Michael Haas, who's very well known as in the field already from the 1990s when he started the Entartete Musik project for Decca, was a producer, since when he's been curating exhibitions in the Vienna Museum, and his most recent project to be co-founding this wonderful Exile Art Center in Vienna University. Michael's written actually the second of his two books on the topic. The first one was 10 years ago. The second one is entitled Music of Exile. And I have to draw the attention that it's a very, very distinct title to our book, which is Music and Exile. But just so that you know that there's a subtle difference between them. And Michael's focus here is on the identity of Austrian composers, but the shifting identities because of the shifting borderlands, the Sudetenland, and the different political forces in the time. And he brings it up to date with a few wonderful rediscoveries of composers that were not previously known about. And you can read more about it. So that's, as it were, close to home. A bit further away, we get to Australia rather than Austria, with Albrecht Dümmling's essay, where he's traced the fate of musicians who were found refuge in Britain, but then only to be deported to internment in Australia. And he actually follows them very detailed way through the camp life in Australia and what happened to them. It's a fascinating study. It's part of a broader study, which he's done previously on the whole topic of Australia, the Australian exile, which he's published in a book. And then finally, we have a sort of groundbreaking, the first ever study of the Austrian migration of Austrian refugees to the Netherlands, by Primavera Gruber, who's based in Vienna. And this is an interesting article because it actually combines the idea of migration and forced migration into one idea, what the sort of subtle difference. In other words, Austrian musicians, of course, worked in the Netherlands, but at a certain point, they were found themselves caught up and could not escape. So in a sense, their voluntary migration became a forced migration. And you have then those who actually fled Austria to the Netherlands to seek refuge. And sadly, of course, some of these people did not then manage to get somewhere safe afterwards and were ended up, as we know, deported and who perished in the camps in Auschwitz. One, of course, being Alma Rosé. So this is a very important sort of contribution, I feel, that there are many people who have not previously been identified, and Primavera Gruber's scholarship is fantastic. I don't want to be too long about this, so I'll just you can see what the titles are. We have Sophie Fettauer's study of life in Shanghai, and this is about the institutional life and what institution was created to support the refugee musicians at that time. And shifting a bit again to a different continent, or back to the UK, Florian Schedding, who is a noted and wonderful scholar on this subject and has written a prize-winning book on migration and is, we're very delighted, is here this evening with us, has written a study of the Free German League and it's this interesting organization which was sort of on the left wing, as one would say at that point, and how the values of that particular organization had certain anti-Semitic tendencies which were sort of hidden and but very important to sort of know how they positioned themselves with the refugees and those who actually wanted eventually to return to Germany to create a different society, which some of them did in East Germany. Finally, in the institutions, we have Rachel Dixon, who's part of the research center and also is a curator at the Ben Uri Art Gallery. Now, although it's an art gallery, the Ben Uri, which actually pre-existed the First World War, in fact, dates almost back to the Second World War predates it, almost goes back to the First World War, acted as a very positive platform for many refugee musicians as well as artists. And there were links between them. For example, one of the artists at the Wiener Library is Lotte Reizenstein, who was the sister of Franz Reizenstein. And another, we know Alexander Gurr, who is one of the sort of senior, as it were, composers who came very young age from Berlin, age 2. His mother was a photographer and exhibited in the Benuri Gallery. So it turns out that very early on, Alexander Gurr's works were performed in that setting. There are going to be papers we're going to hear about Ferdinand Rauter, who came from Austria, Jutta's topic, Norbert Meyn's topic, Peter Gellhorn, émigré composers who came in the 30s, and my own topic, Franz Reizenstein. And there's one composer who we haven't got a paper on now, but very important in that circle is Berthold Goldschmidt, who actually had a sort of revival in the 1980s when he started composing, having had a break for about 25 years of not composing and being a sort of conductor mainly for the BBC. And in the volume, we have two articles because Peter Peterson is very important in this whole field of exile studies. He started a group in the late 1980s in Hamburg for studying exile composers. And this was very early in the whole process, since when many of the people in that group have published books and have gone on to teach this topic. One of them being Barbara Bush, who writes about a particular work, which is the opera Beatrice Sensi by Goldschmidt, and the other person in the group being Jutta herself, who's come from Peterson's group. And we come to the end of this whistle-stop tour of the book. We have wonderful two writers, one in USA, Niels Neubert, who's a vocal coach, who's sung the songs of Max Kowalski, an émigré who settled in London, and whose work is not as well known as it should be, but who traveled to the USA to visit his brother and through a sort of live interview with the nephew of the composer, a picture of his career is developed. And the other article is also about the USA, Hanya Damon's study of two operatic composers I'd not actually heard of before I came to this book, but I'm now a little bit more enlightened about Gorenstetten and Robert Katscher, who had careers, and yet when they went to the USA, did not manage to have a successful type of reintegration into society as one would have hoped. And so that's the topic of her paper. And we end with something, the cinema, music for the cinema. Spolyansky, of course, is a very well-known name, certainly in cabaret circles. And he was a great cabaret composer, but he also wrote film music. And this article by Jörg Tunica looks at the particular uses of the film music. So hopefully there's something for everybody in this book. So I've said something about coming center stage from being on the periphery about this whole field. And in fact, if we look into the past, I think the foundation of this study of music and the Holocaust, or art music, let's say, by composers who were suppressed and persecuted, some of whom survived, but others who didn't, was actually a project to do with the music of Theresienstadt. And this actually, if you can always go back to the 1970s, because that was the time when Victor Ullmann's opera, famously, which he composed in Theresienstadt and was performed, was actually only premiered. We only heard it was in the late 70s. And it took a little bit of time, but the person behind the Theresien project was actually a professor, David Bloch, in Tel Aviv University, who amassed an amazing amount of information and inspired many scholars to sort of pursue that topic and find lost music. And in a way, that sort of stimulated the project. And I put that in a slightly, in the context of a couple of years ago, the BBC choosing in their Holocaust Memorial Day event, presentation to at the Barbican Center, an immersion day, to actually perform these Theresien composers. Now, it might not seem so remarkable, because I think that was probably the first time they did so. And so it took, let's say, 40 years for that research to somehow filter through many performances by different groups, pioneering quartets playing Pavel Haas's music, and pianists playing Gidon Klein's amazing piano music, and people like David Flig, who just wrote a biography of Gidon Klein very recently, was published. So the question is, to what extent, you know, the music will filter into the musical canon, the music repertoire, and those are the works that will be studied by students, because that's how things work, that you have case studies of famous works. So to what extent where are we in that process is one of the questions that comes up with a book like this. But I think what we hope with this volume is that it will be a step in that direction, a step in the pathway to achieving both a core study repertory, let's say, at a certain level, with a lot of historical context, a lot of historical knowledge, but not something which gives it special case treatment. In other words, we want to treat it on its merits, on its value. The music has to be part of our cultural wider cultural heritage seen in sort of with certain aspects brought into play. And we can see that in numerous conferences on music and migration and music and war and exile are showing that there's much more debate and discussion about this. And the other thing is that give respect in a way to the and voice the silenced voices, as they're often called, the music that was lost and needs to be refound, that or was suppressed for all sorts of various reasons, and suppressed actually on both sides of the divide. In other words, sometimes suppressed within the Entartete music tradition, otherwise suppressed as being of foreign extraction in the host country, and or not given enough weight for all sorts of reasons. So refugee studies, exile studies, all these sort of things come into play. And I will stop there because I would like to introduce Jutta to talk about Ferdinand Rauter, after which we'll have a little bit of music, and Norbert after that. But thank you very much, and over to you.
Generally speaking, we can say, if one starts working in this field of music and exile, one cannot leave it. Whatever you do in this direction has something to do with the conviction that you are involved in the right thing. And there is a kind of aura as well. You enter a circle of like-minded colleagues to whom you can always ask questions and find someone to give a helping hand to make progress. And what is the motivation? For me, it has something to do with the gift of insight I received from those exiled musicians I interviewed in my early period as a researcher from Hamburg in London at the beginning of the 90s. They invited me for tea and introduced me to some more musicians, all of whom started talking openly about their lives in Germany and Britain. For instance, Erika Storm, whose home in Hamburg by chance was a street I knew well. She and many others did not harbor hidden feelings or resentment. Even having lost homes, family, and friends, they were still so positive. Afterwards, I discovered through archival research how some of them had really struggled financially. The next stage of discovery was their music. I could not have imagined the extent to which it brought to the foreground the context of WW2 and their new beginnings in a new country. It opened a different world to me, and I felt privileged and full of respect. The subject of my yearbook essay, written in German, is the Austrian musician Ferdinand Rauter as a music therapist in Camp Hill near Aberdeen in Scotland. The subject of my yearbook essay, I would like to tell you how I came across Ferdinand Rauter in Britain. In 1991, I went to London for 7 months to do research regarding exiled musicians from Germany and Austria who found refuge on British soil after 1933. The only person I knew was the composer Bertolt Goldschmidt, who supported me. My days were mostly spent in the now no longer used impressive reading room at the British Museum. There, I came across the program collection of the National Gallery concerts, where the pianist Myra Hess invited musicians of so-called enemy aliens and friendly aliens to perform, mainly chamber music. I discovered that the Icelandic singer Engelund and the Austrian pianist Ferdinand Rauter performed some 26 concerts of Song of Many Lands, with different groups of countries featured between 1939 and 1946, right up to the end of these concerts. Rauter arranged most of the songs for the purpose, whilst Engelund was a linguistic genius and had a unique stage presence. Their songs were always sung in the original language, preceded an English introduction. She carefully prepared and rehearsed, so every word was perfect. No wonder that after their first chance encounter in Hamburg in 1929, their fine and special folk songs interpretations would become hugely successful in Scandinavia, Germany, Austria, Czechoslovakia, Switzerland, Britain, and even in the USA. In 1935, Rauter and Lund settled in Britain in Clarendon Road in Notting Hill, making it the headquarters of concerts and recordings in and outside of England. That was my very first get to know the refugee Rauter from Klagenfurt. Step by step, I learned more about him. After the so-called Anschluss of Austria to the German Reich in 1938, Rauter mediated between Austrian refugee musicians and their British counterparts, helping to release several from internment in 1940 and to establish the Anglo-Austrian Music Society in 1942. After the war was over, and Engelund had already left to visit her homeland, Rauter decided to go to Camp Hill near Aberdeen in Scotland to support Dr. Karl König and his comrades in arms in his anthroposophical project for psychologically and physically impaired children. Claire Kösten, daughter of a Wiener refugee Rauter had met in internment of the Isle of Man, was already there, working for some months with the children. Rauter and Claire got married, worked together under difficult circumstances, and went back to London with their 6-month-old baby, Andrea Rauter, born at Christmas in 1946. We had hoped Andrea would join tonight, but it was not possible, and we are very grateful she is attending virtually. My essay within the yearbook is especially about Rauter's life and his attempts by means of music to support minds and soul of the children he and Claire cared for. A special stroke of luck in my research was the discovery of his diaries, which cover almost his entire life. They are kept in the archive at the Paris Lodron University of Salzburg. Each night, Rauter recorded his personal events in Gabelsberger shorthand, which now has to be transcribed in German. Also, with some personal entrances not open to the public, I was nonetheless able to find out the most important things about his time in Camp Hill. My personal story with Ferdinand Rauter continued to unfold in Hamburg, where I used to live until last year. On the 9th of December 2021, during the Days of Exile, organized by a foundation and the municipality, I gave a lecture on Ferdinand Rauter in British exile. As we also know, Hamburg was the very place where Rauter first performed with Lund, standing in for another pianist. It happened on the 7th of December in 1929. My account of their story of exile in Britain was interspersed by performances by a German soprano and a British pianist of songs from Lund and Rauter, two books of folk songs. At the end, the audience of mainly university students had a chance to ask questions. Who would have thought that 92 years after their first concert at all, the spell of their approach to the songs from many lands was still present? Let's now listen to a short group of three Icelandic folk songs with Rauter's arrangements, sung by Lund with Rauter at the piano.
Fífilbrekka gróin grund, grasur hlýð með berja lautum, flóa tetur fífu sund, fífilbrekka smára grund, íður hjá ég alla stund, unni best í sæld og þrautum. Fífilbrekka gróin grund, grasur hlýð með berja lautum. Ljúfra búi gamli foss, gilið mitt í kletta þröngum, góða skarð með grasa hnoss, ljúfra búi hvítur foss, verð hefur vel með oss, verða mun það en þá löngum. Ljúfra búi gamli foss, gilið mitt í kletta þröngum. Heyrið þið snáða, hvað nú til ráða, það best að bíða og hlýða. Á einum stendur hrifin þjóð með þvegið hár og skjanna, við húsbændunnar holl og góð sem hundra dæmi sanna. Hvað að tarna, hvað sem þurðu þarna, mættum við þá meira að heyra. Alltar vantar brýni, það lifir þar á mís og mjólk en mest á brenni víni. Æ, hvaða skrambi, ætla stand á þambi, mættum við þá meira að heyra. Þar eru blessu bönnum frönds með borðalanda hú, en yfirvöldin illa dönsk á annar hverri þúfu. Hættu nú herra, hér með koma verra sem þér um þetta þegar við segja unna.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Andrea. I'd like to introduce Norbert Meyn, who is the lead, as it were, lead researcher on a wonderful project at the Royal College of Music called Music Migration and Mobility, which evolved from a bigger starting project called Sing a Song in a New Land. And it's a multi-aspect project with interviews and performances and research. So over to Norbert. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Malcolm, for that very kind introduction. And first of all, huge congratulations to you and Jutta for actually pulling this off in the first place. It's an incredible feat of you know, painstaking work that you've undertaken. So thank you very much for doing that. And I'm really pleased to be represented with one article in this book. So I'm a singer and I teach German Lieder and German Diction for Singers at the Royal College of Music. And I've been in Britain now for, I've stopped counting, but probably about 26 years. So I come from Weimar in former East Germany originally. And I worked as a freelance musician in London for many years after I finished my studies at the Guildhall School of Music and Drama. And of course, I, being a German in London, I actually encountered, you know, first generation émigrés like my coach at the Guildhall School, Paul Hamburger, for example, and also second generation, third generation, you know, émigré families. It's been a wonderful journey for me to sort of, yeah, not be really part of it, but to be, you know, connected with that world, because it is a wonderful world. So when in 2012 we were asked at the Royal College if we wanted to be part of a European Union funded project about music and Holocaust education, we said yes. And but we decided to focus on the music of émigré composers who fled the Nazis and came to Britain. And that's how my whole involvement with this field began. Although actually I had performed some Ferdinand Rauter songs in about 2006 or seven. And this is an incredible collection as well. And perhaps, you know, notably also the fact that it was so polyglot, the Rauter music is incredible, because it was all about international understanding. In 2014, we had a conference at the Royal College of Music called Singing a Song in a Foreign Land. And some of you in this room were there. And it was an eye-opener for me personally, but for also many of my colleagues at the Royal College, about the sheer wealth of heritage that we had in Britain. And it was partly our own heritage at the Royal College of Music, with your uncle Joseph Horowitz being there almost every day, and you know, having conversations in the library in a thick Viennese accent, which I very much enjoyed, but also across musical institutions in Britain, the BBC, the Royal Opera House, and the more we looked, the more we found. So we then, after this conference, we started an oral history project, and we recorded interviews with many colleagues and first and second generation émigrés to try to capture some of those memories, which of course, if we don't, they are in danger of being lost. And then in 2016, we were able to do a sort of pilot project of something we had been dreaming up. And that was the Peter Gellhorn project. It was Geraldine Auerbach who made me aware through some films that she shared with us that there was a whole collection of manuscripts of Peter Gellhorn's music in the British Library. And I had actually met him when I was a young musician in London at an audition which he accompanied, and you know, was quite aware of that he was an incredibly special musician and known as a conductor. But like many of my colleagues who knew Peter Gellhorn quite well, I was very surprised that there was this significant body of compositions that nobody had heard of. So we were able with this grant and to have a 6-month project that was basically designed to make editions of these manuscripts and play the music. And we also were able to engage Terence Curran, who is here today, as a cultural engagement fellow on this project. And Terence undertook a lot of archival work and also reconstructed a biography, which of course was not yet properly available. And this is the thing, all this work is about piecing together information from sometimes very few available sources, but also, you know, connecting it with the wider musical history of the time. So the editions and the biography which Terry put together can all now be downloaded on the website of the Royal College of Music. But perhaps a few things to say about Peter Gellhorn in the first place. So he was born in Breslau in 1912, and then the family moved to Berlin in 1923. He was incredibly talented as a musician, and actually already as a teenager earned a significant part of the family income through coaching singers, and then became a student at the Berlin Hochschule für Musik. He studied piano, conducting, and composition. And I think at one of his exams, he was actually allowed to conduct the Berlin Philharmonic. And he had, quite a distinct musical language and started to compose quite early on. And of course, just after he graduated, he was forced to leave Germany and came to Britain, worked at Toynbee Hall in the East End of London as music director, and wrote compositions during that time. And then he was interned on the Isle of Man, like so many other émigré composers, and eventually managed to build a career as a conductor, and worked at the Carl Rosa Company, then at the Royal Opera House in the time of Karl Ranke, who was also an émigré, Austrian born, and then worked at Glyndebourne, and then eventually became the head of the BBC Singers and was a conductor of the BBC. And then went on to coach generations of musicians. So you can all read all this in the article, but for me, perhaps one thing to say is that as a practical musician, I of course, my particular focus is to find the value in the music and in the history that I can sell to my students and to get young musicians interested in actually playing this music. And that is an interesting task, because some of the things about this music that may be interesting to me as a German, or to many of you because it's part of your family history, perhaps, in a wider sense, that might not be of great interest to that younger generation. And in fact, being here at the Wiener Library, the history of the Holocaust that is, of course, connected with those people's lives and with those musicians' lives, but it's not necessarily the most dominant identifier of what this music might be able to tell people. So to associate it with the Holocaust primarily may not actually be the best way forward. And it may be that we can find other connections, find ways of making other connections for this music that are more relevant, or even more relevant to younger musicians today, and also to audiences, wider classical music audiences. So for us, and the Peter Gellhorn project became the sort of pilot for a bigger project that we then undertook at the Royal College of Music from 2019 to 2023. It only finished in September now. We decided to focus on the migration history, and not even just migration, because that is another big word, and it's a very controversial subject in our society, and often very wrongly seen as crisis and stigma. And migration is an important theme here, but even the wider theme of human mobility as such, and that has been what has informed a lot of our research recently. So if you can go to the next slide, I just wanted to show you the online resource on the website of the Royal College of Music, where you can find, now you can download all the, sorry, closer to the microphone. Yes, thank you. So you can download all the sheet music of the Peter Gellhorn edition that we created, but also you can watch oral history interviews. Then you can see stories, long read stories written about several composers, but also musical institutions and the history of migrant musicians or émigré musicians in those institutions. Story maps, and this is actually the geography team from Royal Holloway University of London, who worked with us. They have created dozens of very detailed story maps where you can read a long story, but also follow on maps where these stories happened. And it's the connection between geography and cultural history that has been of great interest there for us. And I hope that it is possible for you to see that this is actually an interesting question. And there are repertoire guides also that include Peter Gellhorn's music, but also many other composers, including Franz Reizenstein and others that you will hear about tonight. And finally, perhaps before I sit down again, I wanted to say that the word exile, which we have used as an identifier for this book, also, of course, talks about geography. And also that is something we need to be aware of, that by identifying musicians and music as exile music, or musicians as exile musicians, we also make a statement about perhaps their belonging. And because exile as a subject is often identifying musicians with their home culture. And what we have found from playing a lot of music written by émigré composers here in Britain over 50 years and more, is that this music is not necessarily best connected with the culture of the home homeland. So it's not really German necessarily doesn't necessarily serve this music to say this is German exile music, was accidentally written in Britain, but really belongs back there. You know, but it is important to actually understand that this is a huge contribution to the cultural environment we all are part of, and that it might be time to also think about how we can represent that in the future. Thank you very much. We have a short musical excerpt with music by Peter Gellhorn, and these are two short. The first one is a minute or so from the Oboe Sonatina, written in Berlin in 1932 when he was a 20-year-old student, which is really very representative of a very distinctive sort of harmonically meandering, very powerful style. And then the second piece is the Capriccio, written in his Toynbee Hall years, so for a very different audience there, which was a much broader audience, but it's a virtuoso piece for violin and piano written for Max Rostal, who was a violin teacher who had come from Berlin with his pupils, including Maria Litka, for whom this piece was written. It is much more, I think, generally pleasing and accessible, but also shows the development of him as a composer. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Norbert, for that wonderful introduction to Peter Gellhorn's music. And actually, there's a lot of interesting things you say there, which I'd just like to, I might comment on in talking about the topic of my contribution to this book. Now, I don't really, in the interest of time, I had prepared a little bit about Franz Reizenstein, but I want to sort of try and condense it in a very quick way so that we can actually get on to our discussion with the panel, because we have both John Reizenstein and Mary Gellhorn here, which is of great interest. And this you can read in the book. But I did want to comment on Norbert's point, which is that about the context of which one should hear the music. Should one hear it in the context of the Holocaust, in the context of the music in exile, or is it speaking on a different level, the music? So in my take actually was the opposite. I was looking at Franz Reizenstein's music actually for quite a long time. I wrote about for the Grove Dictionary of Music quite a long time ago about his career and his music, which is a very varied and wonderful oeuvre. Reizenstein studied with also in Berlin, the same time as Gellhorn, almost exactly contemporary with Hindemith, and was a star student of Hindemith, who gave him a letter of introduction to come to Britain as early as 1934. In fact, apparently Hindemith told all his Jewish students to leave as fast as they could. And he himself, of course, went also to exile. He sort of left Germany. When he was in London, immediately, almost as a postgraduate student, went to study with Vaughan Williams. And here's this concept of stylistic hybridity, I think is very important to bring in to this whole discussion of music in exile, something that Daniel Snowman comments on in his book about Hitler's émigrés, about the confluence of the two different traditions. Do you know whether you're listening? And Norbert, thank you for mentioning my uncle, Joseph Horowitz, who was a professor at the Royal College, but interestingly, who never wanted to call himself an émigré in the same way, because in fact, he arrived in Britain as a young boy. His entire musical education was in the English tradition, and in fact, became a master proponent of sort of writing in that sort of beautiful English choral style. A lot of his choral music has echoes of Murren and Quilter and the sort of lyricism. At the same time, of course, he had the cultural heritage of the Viennese background in which he'd grown, and that there is this element of stylistic hybridity. So to a certain extent, Daniel Snowman is correct when he says you never know whether you're listening to a sort of Viennese orchestra or the sort of the English pastoral scene. It's between. Having said that, it varies from work to work. Now, I wanted to say about Reizenstein that many of his works are abstract works, and I was looking for some works that have some autobiographical element, but I couldn't really find any. But I kept on coming across this notion that he'd written a radio opera called Anna Krauss. There's nothing written about this opera in any of the sort of books, just listed. Apart from it was about a German refugee. It doesn't actually say in many of the books German Jewish refugee, it's about a German refugee. But it's enough to sort of point, well, perhaps this has something to do with it. So my whole focus in my research for the book was actually to find out more about it. It was really exciting. I'm not going to tell you the whole story, but I came across the archives of Christopher Hassel, who's a wonderful actor and biographer and poet, and the librettist for Troilus and Cressida by William Walton, who was also Reizenstein was in the circle of Walton, and he wrote several librettos, but he wrote the libretto to this, having first written the words for, in the 1950s, a piece called Voices of Night, a wonderful choral piece based on poetry from different eras of English poetry. Now, the idea of a refugee from Nuremberg coming and setting echt English poetry, if you want, from different centuries, is already quite compelling. And the way he did it was through Christopher Hassel. They had a very strong bond. They had a friendship which lasted basically all a lifetime friendship. And it produced in 1958 another wonderful piece called Genesis. Now, neither Voices of Night, nor Genesis, nor Anna Krauss are available in the commercial recording catalogue of the last 30 years. And there's a big story there. And part of the story is what the relationship was between Reizenstein and the BBC. Now, on the one hand, he had a very positive relationship. And in fact, Anna Krauss was the BBC's first nomination for the Italia Prize in 1952, the first radio opera produced by the BBC. And it was produced by producer Douglas Cleverdon. And we have a sort of the triumvirate of creative minds behind this first radio opera. And very, very impressively, Douglas Cleverdon was very innovative. In fact, he won the Italia Prize with Dylan Thomas's Amber Milkwood, sorry. I'm frozen in, yeah. But that was the following year. And Franz Reizenstein's opera was innovative in all sorts of ways in terms of radiophonic effects, and that was the whole idea. At the same time, it was an opera. And so when it was judged by the critics, there was this wonderful debate about, you know, do you judge it from operatic terms or do you judge it as radio? And this was part of the sort of discourse, and it makes it very, very interesting. Now, the archives are fascinating. They're in Cambridge University, and the archives of the BBC give rise to a very problematic relationship, because on the one hand, he was accepted, many works were accepted for broadcast, but at the same time, certainly during the war years, things were not accepted. And here's a sort of a desperation letter as an example, a wonderful piece for called Prologue, and Fugue for Passacaglia and Fugue for violin, which was written for Max Rostal and which was submitted several times, rejected by the panel. And he's saying, finally, would you reconsider, because it was reviewed in the Daily Telegraph and given, they said it was my best work, and would you please take it on? Now, the story of that piece is that eventually it did get accepted in the 1940s, and Max Rostal was passed over, and an American violinist was actually the person that gave it its BBC premiere. After which followed a terrible correspondence between Max Rostal and the head of the BBC Radio, the third programme, why he was, you know, how he was badly treated, and some of the sort of issues are quite revealing, let's say. But quite a few works were passed over initially and then took sort of 10 years to get actually accepted for the Home Service and then eventually for Radio 3. At a certain point in 1950s, Reizenstein was actually labeled, panel free. Didn't have to be judged by a panel by that stage. And that's more or less in the 50s when he was writing these works. So here are some sort of rave reviews. Now, I don't want to talk about it too much, except to say that the story is very much about Anna Krauss, who is a German-Jewish refugee, although she's never called that. And the reason we know that is that she talks about her family who's been murdered in a concentration camp. And the name of the concentration camp is Flossenburg. Now, Flossenburg is not the first name of a concentration camp that rolls off one's tongue. But in fact, it was just around 1952 when the war trials were going on, that actually Flossenburg war trials were going in. It might have been actually in the news. But it was within the plot, there's a love interest between a Polish survivor from Flossenburg and Anna Krauss, who's in a quiet English village. And it's quite a compelling radio drama, but it has the background of the Holocaust, and the descriptions of the camp that come into the dialogue quite strongly. So as far as I can see, in 1952, this is one of the earliest, I would say, explicitly Holocaust-themed operas that there are. There are earlier examples, which you can read my article. But I won't go into them. But this one has a lot of the music is very powerful, because it's actually an inner drama. It's about the feelings of this refugee and remembering her parents that she left behind, who she never saw again. And the music sort of evokes that. So it's partly radio drama, partly type of memory. Now, the autobiographical element, well, obviously, we'll hear a bit more about it, but Reizenstein's family, happily, the close family, survived. He managed to get his mother and sister out a few years after he came to London, and another family member survived through another circuitous route. And so he wasn't, it wasn't the same as Anna, literally. Having said that, the Pavel, who's the Polish survivor from the, is a modernist composer who's sort of ridiculed by the village organist because of his modernism. And that's a little bit of a sort of parody in a way of, I suppose, Reizenstein, how he saw himself then, perhaps, you know, that sort of the type of xenophobia and anti-modernism that was going on. And he was being criticized for being quite a modern composer at that time. So there are other autobiographical strains, but the whole topic is very powerful. So I'll stop there. I could just play a very, very short extract, because all there is that we have, and this is part of the point of what I'm trying to say, or the whole study, is that we have a 1952 rather crackly BBC recording conducted by Norman Delmar. Victoria Sladen is Anna Krauss, and we have a 1953 Radio Bremen. They took it on, Austrian, Swiss, and German radio took it on. They were very impressed by it, did a translation. In fact, they changed the name of Flossenburg to Flaxenburg, which doesn't exist as a concept, but in order to sort of, I suppose, make it less more acceptable. And that recording is absolutely wonderful. So the recording quality. So what I would like to see is a performance and a recording and something done with this piece. So here's a quick extract from the aria "At Last I'm Happy," which is Anna Krauss saying she's happy, but then having a sort of inner turmoil. Mary Gellhorn and John Reizenstein to come to the front, and we shall open the discussion to the floor, but we're going to start with just a couple of questions. So let me first of all introduce our guests this evening. So Mary is daughter of Peter Gellhorn, as you've heard, and actually trained as a ballet dancer, yeah, and danced professionally for many years, and then went into the sort of health world of health and physiotherapy or healing, osteopathy. Okay, you can actually introduce us. But anyway, that's there's a sort of continuity then in sort of performance. You went into the performing world.
I think that's one of the things that in our family, in some families, it's like not considered a proper job. But in our house, it was kind of encouraged to do something artistic. And, you know, one of the legacies, I think, for all of us.
It's encouraging. Just a bit slightly closer than the beginning. Now, just quickly, John, before we start the discussion, John actually is the son of Franz Reizenstein, but also a son of another. His mother is also a musician, Margaret Reizenstein, who I remember very well. She had very interesting things to say about music. I used to go to concerts with her, and a very deep understanding. And I'm just going to say that John was, Margaret was born in London, but an immigrant, second generation from Russian and Anglo-Dutch parents, both Orthodox Jews. John has had a career in finance and remains active in the industry as well as the charity sector, but also spends a lot of time managing the archives of both his father and his aunt, the artist Lottie Reizenstein, whose work is included in the Ben Uri Gallery's current exhibition, Verve, good one, and is indeed mentioned in our volume in the chapter on Ben Uri and music. Now, I mentioned that at the beginning that you to ask whether you might bring an object to discuss something which is from your background that would sort of have some personal significance. So over to you, Mary. What did you choose?
So
and
I have
why?
Brought something. I brought the medal that was presented to my dad when he graduated from the Music Academy.
In Berlin?
In Berlin. Yes. Yes, it was in the Royal College of Music exhibition and connected to the project which you did. Yeah. Yes, take it out, yeah.
Well, it's in German. It says, Preußische Akademie der Künste zu Berlin, the Prussian Academy of the Arts, für hervorragende Leistungen preußischer Kunsthochschüler, for outstanding achievements of Prussian sort of art high pupils, so the high pupils of the high arts, yes. Well, it doesn't say the year on here, but 1932, yeah.
Show it around here. But the other thing about bringing an object is that when he came, he couldn't bring anything. And, I don't think he did bring it, because he had to slip across the border as if he was just going on a day trip. So everything was sent later by his mother,
right.
The books, the music, and that. And I also didn't even know that he had that medal until after he died, because he left, he didn't talk about it at all. And
very interesting. And what about when you say his mother sent the, did his mother come?
His mother came after the war. His mother was not Jewish. She stayed in Berlin, and when she couldn't stand the bombing, she went to Dresden, which was lovely and quiet. And then she got caught up in the bombing there.
Mm.
And my English uncle, my mum's brother, was in charge of the transport for the army. And he found her after the war, and then she came back and lived with them in the Fulham Road.
Mm.
But I mean, throughout the war, they weren't able to communicate. So, and his sister stayed in Berlin, and then she went to America, and they actually didn't meet again.
Mm.
So he left a lot behind when he went. And I think, although he put everything into his work, I think although he lost everything, he was very grateful that England had accepted him. There was always a kind of, he looked like he had a great career, but I always felt there was something sad. You know, there's something unrealized, something about what could have been, and there was a bit of frustration, which when he was out working, you wouldn't have maybe noticed, but at home as a child growing up, we never talked about the war. And I was about 10 and I realized they must have, my parents were old enough to have lived in the war. So I would ask a few questions and they always would answer, but very, very short answers. And I got the message it wasn't really okay to talk about it. And they were rather trying to just move forward, move away from it and not think about it. It was just not, just maybe in the 70s, Dad started to go back to Berlin and he met up with his university friends and they'd had a reunion once a year. But even they would not talk about the war. They didn't, and but my dad said that if he had been in their shoes, he doesn't know what he would have done. So there was a lot of compassion and understanding about that.
So they really reconnected.
Yes.
Yeah, that's remarkable.
They were part of a Christian group. I mean, I don't think being Jewish wasn't an issue until 1933. He felt German. And he was allowed to continue his studies at the university because his Jewish father had been an officer in the Kaiser's army. So he was allowed to attend university until it was actually the book that was published that stopped his career. And he came over here. I think he was always really, he loved England and he married a very English wife and all her family. But my impression was that he didn't have a family. And actually, I realized he had a sister, his father came over after the war as well. But he always seemed very isolated, very lonely, not a family person. Even we'd have Christmas parties and he'd go into his music room for a bit. He didn't mingle particularly. So he wasn't the sort of dad that all the other friends in the street had who took part in things and joined in. But it is hard to know how much is because he was a refugee or because of his character. I think you'd have to talk to a lot of children of refugees before a pattern could evolve. It could have been his character as well. Just don't know.
Thank you very much. Yeah, well, let's move on to John. I don't know, I've no idea what you brought with you.
Well, picking up a few things you said, Mary. So I think your dad and my dad were friends. They were at the Hochschule in Berlin at the same time, pretty much. I looking at the Wikipedia entry before I came. So your father studied with Peter Schrecker, who was the boss of Paul Hindemith, who taught my father. And maybe that's why he got a medal, because I don't think my dad got a medal, at least if he did. It never came to me. I do have his final, final exam results, which I should have brought, actually. It's quite amusing, because he was quite mediocre at quite a few things, and reasonably good at one or two other things. He was quite poor at music history, for example. He obviously didn't care much about that. That's quite an amusing and very Prussian piece of paper signed by Leonid Kreutzer and probably Schrecker and certainly Hindemith. The things I bought, I also think I've got a condolence letter from your father to my mother on my father's death, but I think I didn't have time to look for it, but I think it's there somewhere. And the other commonality is that your father and my father both wrote pieces for Maria Lydka. And if you want to know about somebody's really amazing life, read How to Be a Refugee by her father, son, Simon May, because that is truly extraordinary, the story of Maria Lydka and her sisters. The things I bought, and you've already sort of stolen my thunder, I bought the program for Genesis at the Hereford Music Festival, Three Choirs Festival in 1958. And I brought this because I think, I don't know, I mean, my father died when I was 12, so I never talked to him about anything much. But I think this probably represented, you know, the high point of his acceptance into UK society, to be commissioned to write, you know, actually a religious work, to be played in an Anglican cathedral in the Three Choirs Festival. That probably was, you know, he reached his sort of Anglo-Peak, P-E-A-K, not P-I-Q-U-E, of course. You know, having already obviously composed Anna Krauss, as you say, but that's quite a, you know, sort of Germanish work for the reasons you've said. This is entirely English. Also, Christopher Hassel wrote the libretto for it. So I think that's probably, that was thing one. And then I brought a second thing because I thought you wouldn't mind, which is, and again, it goes back to what you said about your father. This is the invitation to accept the Kulturpreis of the Stadt Nuremberg, which he was given in 1964. So a few years after that, he was sort of given this high honor by his hometown. And he did go back and got the prize and everything else. And there's actually a young student in Nuremberg in the same high school, the gymnasium, that my father studied in back in 1930, left in 1930. And this young lady, who's presumably 18 or 19, is writing about my father at the moment. She's for her sort of final essay. And in the process of helping her, I discovered that he made numerous visits to Germany from late 40s, early 50s, which I hadn't known about. I thought he only went back for this, but actually he'd been back a lot, and there was obviously lively stuff going on. You mentioned the Bremen thing, he could have been at that as well. And I just, while we're talking about that school, I went to visit that school in a few months ago in Nuremberg, and they were extremely nice to me. They took me in the back room of the library, and they showed me my father's exam papers from 1930 for his Abitur, including, you know, his religious studies paper and his general studies paper, not all the other papers. But they obviously keep all these things in a very German way, in these massive volumes that I don't suppose many people ever look at, but they're there, talking about archives. Anyway, I looked at his general studies paper, and it's written in the same rather beautiful handwriting that he had. You saw his signature up there, which he must have had the same handwriting all his life. And he's writing in modern Roman characters. But quite a lot of other students in 1930 are still writing in Gothic. And at the bottom, the only comment that the examiners put on the paper is, interesting choice of handwriting. So obviously, he was already quite rebellious, even then. And he'd chosen to use this very modern handwriting. Anyway, these are a few things.
Did they write that in Gothic?
Did they write that in Gothic? Great question. I don't know the answer. Certainly in German, but I don't know about whether it was in Gothic. Anyway, a few random thoughts.
Well, actually, interestingly enough, I think what you said about the genesis is a very interesting piece. It took a long time to get onto back to the BBC. It was done in America, I believe, it was championed by a conductor, and then eventually done sort of outside after this. The Three Choirs Festival, but I mean, as you say, the compilation of the text was done again by Christopher Hassel, and I believe that there was a correspondence which was for me quite moving to read, because I went through the entire thing from 1936, which is when he sort of arrived, and early on with the BBC, with all these sort of where he would really was saying, you know, I've got fantastic reviews, please broadcast, and they said, well, we can't, you know, wait, well. And then in the 1960s, he was writing again about the, when will you do Genesis? When will you do Voices of Night? You know, will you do a recording? And they were saying, well, we sent the score over to there. We've sent the score over here. And they never really sort of said they're going to do it. So I don't know why it wasn't done more. It was an amazing piece. Sorry. That's one thing. And the other thing is, what's amazing, I mean, that he got the prize in 1964, because, and I believe that he played his own piano concerto number 2 in 1962 to inaugurate the Nuremberg concert hall that had just been built, the Meistersinger Hall, and that was sort of part of it. There was that he was given that, because 1962 was so early in this whole process, and we sort of looking at, you know, Goldschmidt was sort of in the 80s in Germany, and got commissions and sort of had a sort of resurgence of interest in the 80s and 90s. And I know my own uncle, who actually knew both Peter and your father very well, and I think probably enjoyed many time when they were young performing duets or doing all sorts of things that musicians do. And I think, you know, he also was given the honor of the Austrian, the city of Vienna, and also the Austrian prize. And that was in sort of in the 2000s or the late 90s and then 2000. And it's interesting, this whole process, but your father is very, very early. And I'm amazed. I mean, did he speak about Germany? You say you didn't know that he was traveling there, but was there?
I just don't know. It's obvious from the visits that he made that he was prepared to get engaged with, you know, post-war German culture pretty quickly, which is interesting. I don't know why. I don't know what went through his mind.
I mean, linked to that, he had carried on the correspondence, the friendship with Hindemith, didn't he? There was a sort of...
Yeah, that carried on. Hindemith was in Switzerland. Yeah, they carried on for a long time, yeah.
Do you think he had a similar sort of... did your father speak about Germany and about, you know, before he reconnected with his friends?
Not before, no, he didn't. I think he just immersed himself in work. He just worked very, very hard.
Did he have any sort of attitude to, like, say, German music? Or, you know, obviously being a coach and working, you're dealing with German texts all the time. And
yes, but with every culture, he loved Czech music. He learned a bit of Czech. He learned Japanese. He'd learn any language. He was quite. I don't think he had a particular thing with German, apart from it was his culture that he'd grown up in. So he felt, I suppose, he felt more at home in it. But he would embrace any of the other mediums, I think.
And you just pick up something you mentioned about he married somebody very English.
Yes.
So did you sort of see him as enjoying this sort of Englishness, or this new in his lifestyle, let's say? Was that
He didn't have a normal lifestyle because he was a musician. So he had his own, our kind of family life revolved around him. And so we were all in another country, really. But my mum was from a very big family and a musical family. And so he always played the piano for our get-togethers. But he had I don't think he loved amateur music that much. Mm. He liked everything to be done correctly. And training.
Yes.
Like to add one sentence by Maria Litka. I interviewed her in 1991, and she told me about her father, and she was so impressed by him and said to me, he was the best musician in England. She was his colleague, and she did several things together, and she was a fantastic violinist. And so then I interviewed your father too.
Did you?
Yeah.
What did he say?
Yes, he was very thankful to be in England. And I felt somehow what you explained about him, he was very much on his own when we talked. And he was thinking, and there was quite a kind of distance to me. My English is a bit rusty, and so I had the feeling it was not so easy to go near to him. What I mean, it was a little bit of distance to me.
So I think he communicated through the music.
Yeah.
I think that was where he channeled all of his his happiness and his passions.
Mm.
I think I can't imagine what it's like to just suddenly have your future taken as it was for him.
Mm.
And then again in England to be interned as well.
Mm.
And yet to be grateful as on top of that. So I think that's the aspect which, rather than someone choosing to move to another country, he had to to survive. And
I can imagine everything what you explained about him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can I just say that we've we've got a little bit of time left, and I would be lovely if somebody, if anyone from the audience would like to ask anything at all to anyone over here. So we can sort of throw this open. And if anyone's got an immediate question, that would be a good. And if not, I can start the ball rolling with one. But either way, you have some. We have an immediate question over there. So, yeah.
Who actually translated Anna Kraus for Radio Bremen?
Oh, somebody.
It's not Günter Eich who did Anne Milkwood for Radio Hamburg.
That's a very quick question, which I can sort of answer by saying, read the book. No, there's a. But I have to. The person that it was sort of the advisor to Radio Bremen who actually wrote a thesis on radio opera, a huge dissertation. He then did the translation, which I've actually seen. And in the beginning scene where the policeman comes to the door and says, "Who lives here?" And she says, "Anna Kraus." I said, "Where are you from?" I'm from Munich, in a sort of accent from Munich. "Oh, foreigner, eh?" is the English. And the German translation is, where did you come from in German? And she says, "Ich bin from München. Says, "Ausländer."
Oh,
doesn't quite work.
People from Munich are like Ausländer for people in Bremen. Their dialects, they can't understand each other if they speak.
But anyway,
there's no communication. Yeah.
I had a question actually for everybody, but while you're sort of thinking of things, which is that all what we're doing is very concerned with archives, and there's archives come into all sorts of ways. And I know that John has been very active in both giving your material, some material, to certain archives, but also informing your own archive. And I know that Mary's also donated many things to the archive that Norbert has been amassing. And I know that Jutta has been using the archive. So I just wonder how you saw your role in the legacy, both of you. Like, how what do you feel do you have a sense of responsibility that it's your, that you, or do you want to perpetuate them?
Yeah, I think I do feel there's some responsibility. Also, for me, there's just so many unanswered questions as well. There's a sort of mystery around his life, and so that's that keeps my attention on the subject of him and his music. But I was so grateful that the Royal College picked up on it, and you've made his music available. So I feel it is available now.
What about John?
Yes, I'm doing spending time on this. So there is a new website which sort of points you in the direction of things you want to listen to, assuming they're listenable. Some of them you might have to go to the British Library to listen to. Publish music if you want to download it or whatever people do nowadays, and generally get to it, because obviously the aim is that people play it really rather than just study it. And in the process of trying to get this thing, well, it is quite organized, I knew that my father had written the music for three films, but I found five more. So we managed to find eight pieces of film music, which is, some of which you can just watch online, and which are quite interesting, some of them. In fact, even the movies are quite interesting, some of them. So that's the website, which is bringing everything together and can be developed in more ways, perhaps in the future. And then I've sponsored a room at the Royal Academy of Music in his name, which is a practice room anyone can use, which has some artifacts on the wall and in cases and so on. It also happens to have a piano donated by Elton John, which makes it, you know, really special room. So that's that. And at the moment, I'm talking to institutions about the printed archive of papers and letters and all sorts of other written materials to do with music, on the one hand, and unpublished manuscripts, including film music, which apparently people find very interesting. So that's all available and being discussed at the moment, to find a home for that. And then I'm going to move on to the family archives and the ones to do with the immigration, which may be of interest to here or other places, that's got to be worked on too. But I think it's right to find a place, if there is one, to for all this to go. And if it's, if people want to then digitize it, at least it's available. It doesn't have to all necessarily be kept in its, you know, original form if it's, if that becomes difficult, but for it just to be available for people to do research or study. And then there are all sorts of other, like you say, mysteries, mysteries which are more interest to me probably than to anyone else, to do with family and so on, where again I'm looking, I'm doing research principally in Germany about members of the family and so on, where there's little information, but it could be quite interesting. In the process of that, I actually found that my father had an uncle who was a chemistry professor in what's that rather nice university town halfway between Nuremberg and Frankfurt, where
Heidelberg?
No, where in fact Barbara Bush lives. No, it's not Erlangen. It's where Barbara Bush lives, in fact, and the Collier. No, anyway. Würzburg. So my father had an uncle who was a chemistry professor in Würzburg, who actually wrote, he, if you could imagine, Christmas in the university in Würzburg, he would write an opera, a comic opera to be played by the, presumably by the staff and the students. And somewhere in the archive in this, in the library of Würzburg University are 8 comic operas written by this uncle. I've, anyway, and actually, would you believe there is an academic in Boston who's written a biography, short biography of this uncle, including references to this oeuvre of comic operas. I mean, I don't know what they're like, and they probably haven't been touched since 1930 something. Anyway, yeah, you find all sorts of interesting things when you try, when you start researching.
Something to explore.
Yeah, it's not just, it's not just for, it's fun as well as, yeah, you know, duty.
All right, I look forward to hearing those coming operas. Yeah. Yeah, so does anybody have any, yeah, yes, please. Do you want to say your name? And
My name is Peter Danheiser. My mother came to Britain as a domestic servant. She was an opera singer in Frankfurt. She had studied in the Frankfurt, now the Conservatoire, where Hindemith actually did his greatest studies and work then. I wanted to ask, your wonderful parents had an impact on everybody around them and possibly in this country. We know that immigrants had a huge impact on music all through the war and after the war and all through the world. I wonder whether you have any thoughts about current problems with so-called illegal immigrants and how we are coping with the huge riches that we could enjoy and perhaps set our face against it at the moment. In other words,
that's a hot potato.
The future. I know, but I said, well, at least, I mean, have you thought about it? Because I have thought about it.
I have, yes. And being a child of a refugee, you just, they're not enemies, you know, that are invading our country in my world. And it's very difficult to see people who've obviously been immigrant, come from an immigrant family, turning against other immigrants. It's very difficult for me.
Yeah, I mean, I actually slightly mentioned this to Norbert once. So this is immigrants and music, and I've sort of challenged you as to, can this be broadened out to different types of migrants? I mean, it's great that it's our sort of migrants, the migrants in my family, in your family. It's great for us to get the attention. But do you feel, rather like the question, that it actually should be broadened out?
Well, I think this is, of course, this is where, for me, the bridge into the present and in the future lives. And if we can't cross that bridge, then we will, it'll remain stuck in so many ways, right? So, I mean, I can say, for example, what this work that we've been doing at the Royal College of Music has led us to now, for example, planning a collaboration with a charity called Hear Me Out, which does music workshops in immigration detention centers in Britain today. And just talking to them and to understand, you know, how they actually function and how the what the reality of their work is now is incredibly humbling. And, you know, and of course, there are so many positive messages from, you know, from your parents' lives. And it's almost, you know, it's such a no-brainer to say, listen, this is incredible cultural capital here. It is not only the fact that there's a legacy of compositions, but also it's the which are actually in themselves really interesting. And if you understand the pioneering nature of this stylistic hybridity, that's the name, the word you used earlier, and that's in fact that's how any innovation works, isn't it? That you find things from different bits and put them together and create something new. And of course, in classical music particularly, we have this assumption that somehow music has, not just music, but also people have roots in places, in the landscape of certain countries that is distinctly different from the landscape of other countries. And you know, you get these sort of images of Vaughan Williams's music, who, for example, who was actually a real friend of refugees, I have to say, but also, you know, campaigned for the national quality of English music and was a musical nationalist in that way. And you sort of see the, you know, symphonies of Vaughan Williams with forests of, or rather no forests in Britain, you know, with moors and moorlands. And actually, I always feel I could just hear that music equally nicely with a beautiful French forest, you know, so that we have inherited a lot of assumptions about culture and of humans, really, about this whole identity politics and belonging politics that, you know, we're dealing with. And you know, people have said that, well, actually, I don't have roots, I have legs as a human being, right? George Steiner, I think, said that. And it's there are these challenges, but I think when we had the exhibition at the Royal College, we had many visitors who had very, you know, current experience of migration, and they did say to me that they felt seen if the music of, you know, of refugees can be celebrated as something that is a huge contribution to cultural life anywhere really, but in a certainly very vibrant cultural environment, which London and Britain certainly is and has been, then there's hope.
That's a good hopeful note on which to end. I mean, I would just sort of add a little rider, which is, I think, the understanding of the sort of the detail of how the refugees, which are refugees at the moment, managed, coped with the different problems is certainly something which you can extrapolate, you know, that gives us an empathy with what refugees are feeling. It shouldn't be sort of the other way around, but also the idea that there was a xenophobia at the time that we're talking about, to become aware of that is very important, because it makes you aware and sensitive to the fact that how societies are working in other cultural contexts, which is what you're talking about now. So I think we have to be more sensitive as a result of our experience of this particular period. And the more that you learn about it, the more you can empathize. Which brings me a little bit to the fact that I'm afraid we're sort of at the end of our time here. I'd like to thank everybody on the panel, Mary and John and Jutta and Norbert. And I'd also like to say that I've omitted to thank Brill, the publishers of this book, they were Brill, as they say. They were brilliant. They publish all the yearbooks, and I believe there's another one in the pipeline for the Research Center of German and Austrian Exile Studies. And so do look out for volume 23. Maybe there'll be a launch in this very place.
So, and thank you to our editors there, Alessandro Gilberto and all the people there. They've offered a generous 50% discount on the book, which I have to mention, and I hope everyone's got the code somehow. And if you don't, do contact the library, or the Wiener Library, and they'll give it to you again. Anyway, but thank you very much for your questions. Thank you for your attention. It's been a long, but I hope enriching and interesting evening. And I hope we can go away and listen to more music by these composers, and a note of hope for the future that that music can in some way help us convey our humanity and get over all sorts of hurdles and challenges in life. Anyway, thank you very much indeed. Thank you.